The Soviets answered the United States this year with their own atomic bomb, a Trinity-sized blast dubbed Operation Lightning. A spy plane detects the explosion's residual radiation the Saturday before Labor Day, so much for the happiness of work, and President Truman gives America the unnerving news later in the month. The public announcement not only signals the end of America's reign as unilateral nuclear power, it reveals to the world that the United States is flying spy planes over Siberia. As if despite these unsettling developments, 1949 is a good time for musicals. This sunny spring, Doris Day as Martha Gibbons mocks atomic power for the lightheaded My Dream Is Yours in Tick, 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 its name an allusion to the sound a Geiger counter makes in radiation's presence. Martha manages to get just about everything about radiation wrong, but maybe this is forgivable, since no one yet quite knows what the thing is. Only that it's immensely powerful, and that it can quickly kill lots of people in horrible ways. Here, Martha owes a lot to Kitty's ditty from I Blame My Parents. The kiss way to Martha's promised land is to be found in the Geiger counter's rhythmic tick, tick. Love makes me tick, she confesses, a little too frankly. The happiness of work in Martha's world also throbs in the Geiger counter's steady, dry pulse.
Like the butcher and the baker ticks, like the candlestick maker ticks, like the doctor and the lawyer ticks, even though he's mixed up in his politics, like the merchant and the Indian chief tick ticks, like the poor like the rich man tick tick ticks, digging a ditch man, the butter and egg man, the poor wooden leg man, the beggar and thief.
Great little personality.
The girl reporters of The Corpse Vanishes and The Phantom Creeps have known about lethal vapors for years, but musicians being a less curious lot, for bubbly Martha, this new mist seems to have risen from the pages of science fiction. She knows it mostly for what it is not. It isn't any larger than an adding machine, she muses, ticking off possibilities. It doesn't want to be a bird. It doesn't want to fly. It's sad that Martha's tick, which she credits as the fundament of love and prosperity, has no such transcendent aspirations. It's hard not to register something sinister in Martha's frivolity, how easily she shrugs off the most toxic and terrifying means of affecting mass death in modern war. What are we to make of her puppy-eyed insistence that we join her in accepting atomic fallout as no big deal? When one's proposition is faulty, and arguments advocating the harmlessness of atomic radiation certainly have their flaws, one must resort to emotional appeals and other dishonest means of persuasion. Just as much as the click of lab equipment or the beating of a loving heart, Martha's tick, tick, tick evokes the ticking sway of the hypnotic pendulum watch. Oh, give me your attention, the song opens. There's been a new invention. Though the first line seems superfluous, what could be a bigger attention getter than an atomic explosion? The second truly taps the mood that spring. The United States is avidly spending its peace dividend by using invention to reconfigure public life, though these new fixtures are as yet slow to radiate through suburbia's long stretches. Less than 0.5% of households own a TV set, its dissemination hindered not only by its cost, but also by the hostility of cultural commentators. Saturday Review editor Norman Cousins criticizes the emerging technology as a billion-dollar blunder, his critique being more that it's misused to pander to a lowest common denominator than that it's inherently evil. A potentially great tool, it is being murdered in the cradle. Where most often encountered, which aside from showroom windows is in taverns and saloons, it stands accused of spreading other malignancies. Thanks to the intrusion of a garrulous pictorial contraption called television, mopes the New York Times, the saloon now harbors a horde of mutes. Conversation is drawn into the chattering electric box and swallowed, the bar transformed from a line of socializing citizens to a procession of silent, targeted stares. TV gives this previously level, heterogeneous space a focal point. There's been a new invention. Give it your attention. Unable to afford a set for their home, the average household can at least watch at the corner tavern without fear of missing dinner invitations with the Tell Magnet, a bulky device that lets callers leave messages at the instruction of sound recordings the heads of households make themselves. The only problem is the Tell Magnet costs about as much as a TV. The workaday American can at least stomach the cost of the device on which the message is recorded, the 45 RPM single, which RCA reveals this year as an answer to Columbia's long-playing record, itself only a few months old. Though Charles Ponzi dies this year, his love of illusion and the art of sales is carried forth with Cintron Corporation's speech, platform, posture, and appearance, episode 619, short subject. Here, image is paramount. Our authoritative narrator, ever present at the outset to guide our thoughts and opinions, spells for us a hypothetical.
Now just suppose you were a beautiful doll with rosy cheeks and big blue eyes. A doll that never talked.
He then asks you to imagine yourself as a tree and a spring flower.
You'd be judged mostly by your appearance.
This is truer of the first example than the second and third. A doll is designed mainly to be looked at, though it is also often held, a reason to judge it by its texture. Trees and flowers could just as easily be judged as requisite to human life, since they gift us with carbon dioxide and pollen, respectively. But never mind that. The aim here is not to posit a freshman year philosophical contemplation, but to impress on the viewer the importance of presenting an ordered image to winning over an audience. We're told of the need for standing straight and balanced, controlling one's gestures, holding up one's head, and making eye contact. In appearance, we see these Ponzi scheme in rudiment. This confidence racket reflects a vital aspect of the American heritage, the con, the tantalizing prospect or dazzling show, embodied too in our sucker-born every-minute mystique, our susceptibility to gold rushes and heartfelt revivals. A good presentation is the first step in any good con. Another aspect of the Ponzi scheme is reflected in appearance, too. The pyramid sellers are enticed to act against their own self-interest through a clever program of enticements, alternating carrots and sticks, and half-truths. Coincidentally, large-scale LSD experiments begin this year as the drug first becomes commercially available. This is done mainly by the Army, and it is to make test subjects perform tasks based on the processing of simple information. Reveal, accept, remember, forget. As in the Ponzi scheme, here trickery is used to boil down the psyche to building blocks and manipulate them to coerce thoughts and behaviors. You are not only to remember, but to manifest these simple instructions. Think tall, talk tall, stand tall, and walk tall. The narrator of appearance, speech, and posture repeats with the help of visual aids. This gives the receptive viewer a ready cue to alter herself and guidance on how, when she finds herself slipping. Distraction is its own prompt to clear her mind, poor diction its own prompt to speak clearly, and so on. While the behaviors being entrained here are not so autonomic as is the case with the Army's LSD experiments, the exercise is basically the same. While the girls shake at the Fallout musicals, the boys thrill to shootouts set and staged in the same American Southwest that saw the first test of the atomic bomb. The Lone Ranger moseys on over to television in 1949, and those few kids lucky enough to have parents who can afford a set or can peer through the glass into a tavern that has one on can witness the adventures of a hero they've only been able to imagine, many for their entire lives. Once televised, one writer muses much later, the question of the Lone Ranger's hidden identity becomes one of mystery, transformation, and initiation, thanks to the new medium. The kids peering through the tavern windows get to see the Lone Ranger's true face. Radio listeners never had the privilege.
The Lone Ranger.
The public school students of Dearborn, Michigan, on the other hand, are having to make do with Junior Rodeo Daredevils, episode 407, short subject, a film being presented as another free service by the city of Dearborn, Michigan. as Bobby Lee and Nephew Mike are cousins of our two friends Johnny, so too the junior rodeo is a cousin to the county fair. Only Johnny and his rivals nurture their calves in pursuit of ribbons, while the youngsters at the junior rodeo ride theirs in a prolegomena to lethal conflict. The film unspools in the orderly way of a lesson, that is, it follows the presumed rodeo program, progressing by event and then by age of rider. The youngsters trade rides with the adolescents and young adults, each paired with an animal of commensurate size and strength. The object of rodeo isn't to vanquish, it's simply to endure. The rider, in his conscious mind, can contemplate the some second ignoregnum that separates him from victory. The beast can only kick its way to the sound that signals its release. The beast knows nothing of seconds, minutes, or hours. As the children rise to adulthood, so too do the beasts grow fully, and the rodeo sessions graduate from sport to deathly wrangle. The 16mm camera captures the teenage rider's moment of twisted agony as the emerging creature bucks into the limit of his spine. Meanwhile, the rider's peers look on. The motion picture is today as it was at its inception, a thief and snitch stealing the flows of nature, capturing physicality at maybe its least or maybe its most worthy moment of reproduction, the moment of spiritual extremity, of nearness to injury or death. The suffering flickers away on screen like any other moment. Neither the camera nor the screen affords it any particular weight or dignity. The rodeo stage here verges on Colosseum, and the rider rides the edge of sacrifice. What if he loses his life here before all his peers? To die in public and in this time of peace, is this what it means for a man to come of age? As a girl steals the blue ribbon from Johnny, so too is the feminine ascendant in the world of rodeo. Betty's in high school, and though she doesn't quite plumb the kinetic frontiers of her older peer, she holds her own. Between her and the blue ribbon winner of Day at the Fair, is there any reward a male can plumb that a female can't as well? One imagines this is a concern to Orville Hubbard, the local mayor responsible for presenting this film as a free public service, but if so, his work doesn't let on. A lifelong segregationist, Hubbard is ever alert to the prospect of encroaching diversity. He has already fought an affordable housing project, warning of the importance of keeping the Negroes out of Dearborn. By what set of rules, then, is he so hostile to those of another color but not of another sex? Old Timer Billy Slater presents Bobby Lee and Nephew Mike with a strange totem at the outset of junior rodeo. Hilariously, the boys have tied a tin can to a horse's tail, but Slater spies them and lassos them in. In the old man's youth, the town had hanged many an hombre for horse rustling. He presents the two children with a downsized replica of the gibbet's mast from which the thieves' lifeless bodies must have swung. One day they too could hang from the noose's creaking rope, old timer Billy Slater warns, if they're not careful.
Sheriff Billy Slater has a hanging tree all ready for horse rustlers. You know, he told Bobby and Mike, when I was young, many an hombre got hanged for fooling with horses. But I've got another plan for you.